and my left eye was open. And I leaned back like this, and I couldn't see the screen really, but it looked like my entire body had become black, except for my face. And my face was like narrow looking, like, and just like, meh. And so I was like, because if I fucking play the video back once this is over, you're going to be able to see the monster that's there. Chin Chin. This is a video that's going to kill, This video, okay, so Nick was going to meetings. Nick was living in Ohio, and he was having problems with drinking. Not Nick Crespo. My boyfriend from high school. My brother. And had moved back to Michigan and was living with a man named Dale Armstrong. But didn't look like himself. Kind of looks like his son. One night, when was this video made? It says 6 months ago. Okay. There was a night at the Unity Church in Livonia where, here's how I met Nick and Dale. They had gotten out of rehab together, and they were living together and trying to keep each other sober and going to meetings every day. And sometimes Dale would come to the meetings without Nick. And would complain about how Nick was always playing video games and was has his headphones on. And it was not Dale, though. It wasn't Dale. Like, it was, Dale was like two different Dales, you know? Like, and sometimes he was very positive, and then sometimes he'd be like, you know? And so when Nick wasn't there, he would say that Nick was always playing video games and just always on his headphones and just bitching about him because that was evil Dale. Yeah, that was the one from hell that didn't like Nick just because Nick is my brother and the story is gonna kill them. They're going back to hell for all eternity. And so one night at the Unity Church in Livonia on a Sunday, there was a huge meeting going on. I had never seen that many people there, and I'd been going there for many years. I mean, I've been in the program for over 10 years now, and it's just, you know, to help me and be, stay connected with humans, you know? And so I saw Nick, and I'd seen him in a long time at the meetings, and I go, hey, you want to sit at this table? And he's like, okay, and he sat down, and one of the girls got up and started saying something into a microphone. She goes, you never know, tomorrow might be the greatest day of your life. And I was like, what? That's kind of weird to say that. And so Nick was talking, and because we had four people at our table, but there was over 100 people there is what I'm saying. Like, usually there's like maybe 30, 40. There were so many of them. Everybody at the meetings is dead but me, including my brother. And so he had been at the meeting with Dale and Farmington Hills, and they brought a pizza. And Dale goes, Nick wants to be the hero and, you know, bring the pizza in. And I was like, oh, awesome. And we were all eating pizza because I was starving, you know, and I didn't eat anything all day. And I didn't realize it then, but the other person that was there that night, I believe, is Eddie Bray's brother, but is at a post of somebody that was going by the name Shannon Boyle, and he had a really bad problem with heroin, and he was living basically on the street, but he was also a musician, and he has a YouTube, fucker's coming downstairs. Pocket polo. And when I was 15, me and Marie Gajev, I said she was my date for the night, but not like that, you know, she's my best friend. Went to, because I was the bridesmaid, my cousin Kelly Bray's, Watkins is her last name. What's up?
Nothing's up. See what's going on outside in the weather.
Wedding. And for the bridal party, I walked down the aisle with Eddie's brother, Dave. And Dave is about the same height as Eddie. And I was wearing, all the bridesmaids were wearing red dresses. And me and my cousin Josh, respect, he got a little drunk in the limo because all the bridesmaids and groomsmen, and Josh was starting to pass out. And I was like, Josh, wake up, you got to keep it together because we're at a wedding. And like the reception, I was sitting with Marie, and like it was nice. And that was the only time I ever met Dave. This person that was coming to the meetings as well was looked like Dave, but was like 10 inches shorter, okay? Looking about like a little bit taller than me. And I was like, this guy kind of looks like Eddie Bray's brother that I walked down the aisle with at the wedding. He was a bridesmaid and a groomsman. And we became friends. And they did some really fucked up shit to him, too, because he was like, he became kind of like one of my only friends at the meeting. And when we would like sit together, like we would talk. And it was like he was trying to tell me something, but he couldn't say it. Like, because it's not his identity. And so he was introducing himself at the meetings as Dan Boyle. But in the meetings, Shannon, but before he got hunted by $10 Tommy, I think he was going by Shannon Boyle. I'll talk about $10 Tommy and how they were picking off the last of the humans that were still alive that kept getting murdered and coming back, including Maddie and Gerald Owens. I believe Gerald is dead, but Maddie is not. I'm not sure what her last name's Kaufman, like Dr. Kaufman. And Trevang is, Trevang Tripathi is actually Nikki. What's up, Nikki? You know, the fucking, the Hodge Danson video of him being at the post of motherfucker, one of the worst, yeah. Who is going by the name James Alfred Wood, but is stealing the identity of Alfred James Wood the Third, but their last name isn't even Wood. And Nikki, I'm sorry, Shevang posted Bovice. Yeah, posted a video of himself slash herself, itself, because it's neither of them, but she's there. You know, she's got to be at the post, the one stealing her brother's identity. I actually saw a picture of her. He was holding up a photo of him and her. And I go, oh, my God. I go, I know her from Harrison. That's Kate Buckner's best friend. I go, is that Nikki? And I thought in my head, is that Nikki Tripathi? And I go, is that Nikki? And then I said to him, hey, is that your sister? And he got, like, nervous. No, that's my aunt. I was like, okay, she looks like a girl I went to high school with. It was like a year or two younger than me. I can't remember exactly what grade she was in. Because we were all friends, and like, you know, it's just sometimes you'd have classes where an upperclassman, like a senior or junior, would be in a class with a freshman. And for me, I wanted to be on the school newspaper, so I took creative writing my freshman year. And nobody else in the class was a freshman, but I really wanted to be on the newspaper, and so I got to be on the newspaper my sophomore year, and so that was really cool because, you know, but that's how you meet people, and you're all just like a year or two apart, and that's how me and Dan met, because we had a sale class together, we had a homeroom class together, and but I talked about it, and now I want to just say really quick, the night at the meeting where there was a whole bunch of people, Nick looked afraid. Like, when he sat down and he was talking, and it sounded like he was trying to tell me something, like, we're all worth something, and you just got to remember your self-worth, you know? He goes, I don't trust a lot of people. And I had to be there for probation because I had done nothing wrong but found a bunch of rolled-up carpet in the woods and the ones that are stealing my parents' identities called the police on me. Because they found a pipe. Could have been used as a fucking straw to drink water out of. It could have been used to smoke marijuana or crack. Had nothing in it. But they called the police on me because they were scared because they knew that I was going to find out the truth. Kind of like when they kicked me out of the house in 2014 because Dan Rivasell was working with somebody in his family, but he looks like his nephew that hasn't been conceived yet with his sister and my brother. Not Nick, but the He's in the movie Big Top Pee Wee. And Mike Nelson's not his last name. Because Dan's got a sister, and her name is Megan, and my brother, and Megan, if they had a baby, because Megan's really beautiful, she added me on, she had to actually live as Dan, Dan's twin brother was not his twin brother, that was his sister, and she literally doesn't look nothing like Dan, at all, but, she had to live like that for a long period of her life, I'm pretty sure, because, my brother had to live looking like his unborn daughter with her, so, this one stealing Dan's identity, is with an it named Christina Horn. And Christina Horn and how Dan looks now as Game Grumps are brother and sister, but they haven't even been conceived yet. So Dan looks like his nephew. Meanwhile, fake Dan, one of the two fake Dans, because there's Steve Jennings, who's Cabin Fever, and then there's Dan Rebocell, who was looking kind of looked like Rob Adair, didn't he? Going by somebody else, and Christina Horn was engaged to him. And my brother was actually working manual labor. Like, so this girl is working manual labor. She got dark brown hair, and she's working these, like, she's a welder. Yeah, she's working as a welder. Okay, that's definitely a man there that's working. And so me and Dan Rebocell were supposed to be married, and my siblings are all supposed to be alive. Spark master tape. And Dan, that's why I'm kind of panicked, because I want Dan Rebocell to know that if he doesn't know, the reason he looks the way that he does is because he looks like his unborn nephew. And he needs to know that, but he's Game Grumps, and like they're probably trying to get him to like date, and YouTube's very evil. Yeah, YouTube is very evil right now. And they've been blocking a lot of my videos because they think they own technology. You don't have access to technology after this, I promise you. I'm going to play this video. They abducted him, I'm pretty sure. They abducted Nick, who looks like his unborn son. And when I looked at him at the meeting, I kind of like for a second, I was like, he kind of looks like the biblical like paintings, like the Renaissance paintings from the Italy and like back in the like 1300s, 1400s, like of Jesus. Like how Jesus looked. And after the meeting, I walked up to him because I was like, I feel like that's my brother, but I can't like just be like, hey, bro. You know, like I was just finding it out, like everything about the hospital. We were just little babies, and they kept murdered. They sent my father home during the delivery. They said he couldn't be there. And they murdered my mother, and she was already dead. And then when they murdered her, she was gone. And the motherfucker stealing her identity, who's like the absolute most evil of all evil, was like raping my father after that. Because if they were into it, you can see in that one video I made, like he's sitting outside and he looks so afraid because he was still alive until he was 1988. He was 43 years old. And they murdered him, and then because I was just a baby, my brain's still developing. I don't have a lot of memories from my childhood. Plus, they were chopping me up every day. We moved into this house, and suddenly, after December, when they murdered me and my father here, there was like six of them at the door. I remember that. That's all I remember. I remember them opening the door, and there was like a bunch of men at the door. One was wearing a white wife beater, like a white, they're called wife beaters, but it's like a tank top. And had a bald head, and they kind of looked like demented. Like, their faces looked like, not human. Like, the hills have eyes, kind of, yeah. And they were, like, smiling. There might have been more than six of them, but they were all at the door, and the door just swung open, and I was standing in the kitchen, and I looked over. I was just a little baby, so I was, like, only 3 years old, 3 and a half. Looked over, saw them, and that's it. But God allowed me to see the vision in a flashback. The night that I died that night, I only remember the last few seconds of my life, and I was thrown down the stairs head first. And I have the memory of where the staircase is like this in my basement. I'll get back to the story of the Unity Church in a minute. There's the wall with the guard rail, you know, the thing you hold on to when you walk down the stairs. And then there's another wall, and then the wall stops. It's a partition, and there's like a slide. And when I was a little girl, like 3, 4, 5, 6, when we moved into this house, 3 and a half, we moved into this house, I would, once me and my friends would stop at the partition, me and Jenny and Katie, and like I would slide down that little slide. I would get on it and I would slide down it like it was a little slide. That's the part I remember from waking up in my bed at 3 and a half years old. I was like laying down, got up like this. And even as a little baby, just a little girl, I was, because I was a toddler, you know, but I knew that I had died because the feeling was so like crushing and painful and it was so depressing. I was like, my life just started and I'm dying. And I'm just a baby. I could actually hear, it was almost like God was saying, but my life just started. And it was like the moment right before my head hit the ground and it was, that memory was repressed until about 4 or 5 years ago, and I kept hearing a sound that sounded like a child falling down the stairs, or like a small person. Child, yeah, or small person. I wasn't a small person, I was a baby, because God kept bringing me back alive. So let's go back to the Unity Church. After the meeting, I walked up to Nick. People were still talking at the tables, but me and another table with like 4 to 5 people each were getting up to leave the meeting. And I said, hey, I go, you know, if you ever need a ride to a meeting, me and this motherfucker here, who I have to call mom or else they'll call the police. I mean, I didn't say that. I just said, I can pick you up, but I drive with the motherfucker in the Denali. I didn't say that either. I said, my mother, yeah, because they were really, really upset every time I started to talk out loud. That's why when they come downstairs, I have to get quiet, because they'll call the police on me for talking out loud, and then I'll go to a psych ward for 2 weeks, and we might not have 2 weeks. Also, I was murdered at Havenwick, and I will talk to Kelly Worley about how they went into the room and kidnapped me out of the room, and then I woke up in the morning, and she was crying. She was my roommate there, yeah, because it's two women to a room at Havenwick, which is a safe hospital, a safe psychiatric establishment for crazy girls who have rocks thrown through their window because they're still alive, or have people waiting outside to come in, or, you know, whatever, because most of the people there are still alive, you know, they got to pick us off, and so you can't get out of a psych ward if you're police petitioned, unless you are done with your time stay there, and you get there's no such thing as a 5150 anymore. You have to stay there 2 weeks. It's only a matter of time, unless this is stopped, before they'll start throwing us in for a year, 2 years. If 3 years at a time like they used to. You'll die in the psych ward, and they'll just perform experiments on you every day, knowing you'll come back alive for 7 years. That's what they did to Dan. They kept him in blood-soaked boxers because they cut his dick off and put a catheter in where his penis was. So I said, Nick, oh, I didn't say Nick, I said, if you ever need a ride, we can pick you up. How he was talking at the meeting and what he said to me, what it said to me, were two totally different vibes. Goes, yeah, Dale's got your number. I was like, okay. I walked away. Walked out. Got in the car with motherfucker. Drove about 2 or 3 miles down the road from 5 miles, 6 miles, 7 miles. Oh, we were up kind of close by the Jeffrey Animal Hospital. You know, where they took Misty, right? Motherfucker that's upstairs right now. They really actually threw her in a washing machine to have her euthanized because of the cancer on her. And what did I say? said I forgot to get my sheet signed. Fuck. I have to have the sheet signed or I'll go to jail for a year. We drove back here. Not here. You don't want me to say this right now. Start playing the video then. We drove back to the meeting. All the cars of over 100 people were still there. There were two men standing outside, guarding the door. Hold on. There were two men guarding the door. One of them was a man named Bill. Not Bill who was having his identity stolen and was actually, not Charles Manson Bill, who's super cool, he's really funny, but another Bill, who at the meeting had said, "Hey, Nikki," and he looked down at my phone and I was looking at a cool Halloween costume. He goes, "Isn't it a little late in the year for Halloween costumes?" And I was like, "Oh, hi, Bill." I was like, "Yeah, I was just looking online because it was cool, you know," and gave him a hug, and then he walked away. But that was the man that was standing outside, though. And they're like this. And so I rolled the window down from the passenger seat of the Denali, and I go, "Hey, Bill." Looked at me like he didn't even recognize me. And he walks up to the car with the guy, and goes, "Yeah," and I go, "I forgot to have my sheet signed in there. Could you sign it for me?" Usually after an NA meeting, everybody's outside smoking cigarettes and talking. I had already been in that passenger seat and driven almost 4 miles that way up. Well, I hadn't driven. That one drove. But we were already 4 miles up that way by the Jeffrey Animal Hospital, a 9 mile in Middlebelt. We had to drive all the way back to 5 mile in Middlebelt. That's almost 10 minutes. The tables were letting out. But I was probably the first person to get in the car because I wanted to just, you know, leave after that. And that's why, because I forgot to get my sheet signed. When we went back, either most of the cars would have been gone or there would have been people outside. The tables were letting out. Where did everybody go? Why are they all still inside the Unity Church if the meeting's over? Not only that, Nick was standing outside by himself when we drove away, waiting for Dale to be done with the meeting, because he was at another table. Nick was no longer outside, but Dale was still there. All the cars were still there. Nobody's outside. I handed Bill from the passenger seat of the car out the window my court-ordered sign sheet. And he goes, "I don't know, did I see you in there?" "What do you mean? You gave me a hug. You walked up to me. I was looking on Instagram." And he goes, "All right." Starts signing it. And his buddy, like, realizes, you know, that I'm realizing something's not right. He goes, "Isn't that the most important part of coming to the meeting? So you get him signed? Get your sheet signed?" And I was like, "Yeah, I just forgot." And he hands me the sheet back. Nobody's come outside still. And they go back to guarding the door, and we drove off. Nick didn't come to another meeting with Dale after that. Isn't the guy in here doing the surgery? A lobotomy. Look, it's Nick from the meeting. Isn't it the actor from The Hills Have Eyes? And The Devil's Rejects, which is the second House of Horses movie? Yeah, he's an actor. Yeah, he's my great uncle. Either my uncle, no, he's not my uncle. He's my great uncle. He's going to be doing a lobotomy, yeah, right, on his possessed great-nephew, or grand-nephew. It's called a grand-uncle, because it's my grandfather's. Oh, my God. Why are they cutting his head open? Why was this video taken down off the internet and it had to be re-uploaded by somebody else? This is a Nine Inch Nails music video. Oh, my God. Why is there a little girl in the room handing the doctor what they need to perform the surgery to get the demon out of his brain? Vacuuming. Get him out. Get him out of my house. So basically, Satan is wearing my granduncle's face instead of my Uncle Bernardo's face, like in the Dr. Domino video that nobody's seen yet, but I went in to get stitches on my chin, and this is after my father died, so I'd be about 4 years old in the video. And after they started doing the stitching of my chin, I don't remember what happened. Woke up in my bed. Oh, that was in there. Yep, just a bunch of ashes in his brain. He must have really, really fried his brain from all the alcohol. So he couldn't be kidnapped him from the movie show to pick him from there. Yeah, that was in his brain. Yeah, that's what happened. You motherfuckers are dead. All of you are down to death. The death people is the mark of the beast. And then we're going back to hell. It's going to go back to hell. We're leaving our psychotic pieces of shit. On the other side of the common wall in my basement. Actually, I think it's an apartment that's like 2 floors down. How do I get access to these apartments that are on my property, but I didn't even know existed? So the past few years, when I discovered that there were anomalies about the architecture of the house, it didn't make a sense. And I could hear people. I actually smelled crack one day. Somebody was smoking crack in my basement. How is that possible? There's a common wall. And then from there, there's 30 floors of apartments. And Nikki Tripathi, who looks like her brother now, took a video of what one of the apartments looks like. And it's got the same light fixture, that very ugly 1980s mirrored light fixture above the sink in the bathroom. Same 4 lights with a mirrored base. And same tile in the basement, same tile as the bathroom in the basement, same molding around the door, and the apartment is green. Again, how do I get to these properties that are on my property line that have people living in them? When I stick the endoscope through the holes in the ceiling, they start to glitch out. As soon as the hand of God has been returned to God, who is our creator, who is not going to let them out of hell and is going to separate the enslavement that's been over 4,000 years. So they're all going back to hell. You're going to see in videos what these things that were forcing us to live in tandem if we were dead and stealing human identities 2, 3, 4 generations removed and making sure that the parents never met so the children could never be conceived by forcing women to live as men and men to live as women. You're going to see what these things actually look like, and they're hideous. They're not human.